and we are Mr. Hawkins of Mars Space Flight Center of NASA. He is the lead engineer for Space Launch Systems. He's an electrical engineer, but he has applied extensively in many other areas, in mechanical and thermal and other areas. His background itself is varied. He comes from DoD and submarine warfare and aerospace areas. I'm going to do the presentation and let him take over. Wanted to mention one thing. This is an international forum, and everything is being recorded for the sake of recording the videos. Sure that no discussion, any public discussion that happens here is non-ITAR and is a public release. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Having a good day so far. I really appreciate the invitation to come up and speak to you today. Thank you very much for the introduction. What I might be interested in hearing about is a little bit of an introduction to our space launch system. I'm going to talk to you about the launch vehicle work that we're doing at Marshall. And it's interesting work, and so I have attended a flight software conference here. Most of you are probably involved in science projects, maybe some on launch vehicle. But what we're talking about today is the capability that Space Launch System will provide for human exploration of space, but also science community or scientific community, because we will improve our capability to lift weight and a lot of volume to low Earth orbit as well as beyond Earth orbit. And I think interest to many of you here. And please ask a question you might have. As the vote indicated, we do have to keep the material at our level. So some numbers might be somewhat generic or high level. I apologize for that. But just given the nature of the forum, we'll have to do that. So without further ado, go ahead and get started. Make sure I can. Pretty busy introductory chart. Some public relations from NASA about Journey to Mars. But what we're talking about today, of course, is Space Launch System. Make sure I get it. Chart, but we'll focus on Space Launch System and the fact that the Space Launch System that we're developing has a heavy lift capability. And it will be enabler for us to do some of the things that you see here on this chart. As most of you know, from a human exploration perspective, we've been in low Earth orbit now for quite some time. But what it will give us the capability to do, of course, is leave Earth orbit once again and start exploring things that we haven't been able to do, again, in quite some time with respect to human exploration. And you'll see a schedule for that toward the end of the presentation. It will hopefully be about 3 years from now. It'll be uncrewed, and we will launch Orion or MPCV into low Earth orbit. We'll leave low Earth orbit, and they will loiter in cislunar space, I think maybe for upwards of about 2 weeks. And then our launch after that will be a crewed capability. We'll probably still loiter in cislunar space. Science fiction any longer will actually be something that we can talk about. out, and that is actual human exploration of Mars. So what we're doing on the system, when the program in 2011, these are three goals of the program. Since it's a human vehicle, we have to take consideration, and what we have on this vehicle that we really have on the shuttle is a pretty robust abort capability. We put the system on SLS, it can give a pretty high, reliable abort capability in the event you have some kind of malfunction during the accident. Ability into consideration, a lot of what we do is all about work on our projects from small projects even up to very large projects. I mean, I don't think there's probably anyone in this room that wouldn't have more money, access to more resources. We deal with those kind of constraints. Affordability is a big constraint we have to live with, and we've made a lot of key architectural design decisions, based on affordability constraints. And you'll see in the architecture, reuse the shuttle propulsion components as a result of that, whether a key for us in terms of defining the architecture of the vehicle. More sustainability. Now, the initial version of a vehicle will be able to lift about 70 metric tons orbit. The new vehicle, which will be a Block 1B variant, will add a more robust upper stage, will be able to lift with that variant of the vehicle about 105 metric tons. And in the configuration of the vehicle, we hope to provide a capability to lift upwards of 130 metric tons. And you'll in one or two of my slides, varying sizes we're looking at, there'll be a large volume that you can lift as well in addition to that weight. Orbit comparison, you'll see from shuttle comparable to Delta IV Heavy. Some of the commercial launch. This is with Saturn, about 100 metric tons. Block 1, we won't be near a Saturn capability, but with the configuration of the vehicle, we'll see the amount of weight that Saturn was able to lift into orbit. So, capability of the country, as well as others will buy. This is the capability of the vehicle will provide with respect to the science community. So the Europa mission, Europa on the Space Launch System, probably in the early 2020s. I think they want to launch maybe in 2021, 2022 time. But by us, Europa about 4 years ahead of when they would have been able to get there using the Atlas V launch. Given the weight and the payload in. So this is where we're at today. So this is today's configuration for Space Launch System. You guys are the first to see, this is the new color. Some of the comments on the internet about the Space Launch System. So last week or before this past week, you would be pretty much Saturn V. But what we did, of course, is we made the same decision to man the shuttle program. For those who remember, on STS 1 through 4, the first shuttle, the external tank was white. We painted it with a top coat. That top coat off of shuttle and STS 5 and saved about 7,000 pounds. So, decision here. So what you see here, this is a spray-on foam insulation stage. So right here, we have an oxygen tank with hydrogen. So now it's just that sprayable foam insulation. We have these racing stripes on the SRB. I'm not going to Strength and Stripes will stay there. Our imagery folks would like that too much because we do have some high contrast markings on the vehicle that we're going to use, obviously, in the first couple of launches to collect some data about clearance, pad clearance, things of that nature. So we can fly, I think SOS or EM1, our first mission, we'll fly an Orion, but it'll be an uncrewed Orion on top of the vehicle. This is that launch support system I mentioned. When we start mentioning these variants of the vehicle, the next configuration will be the first Block 1B. The difference between Block 1B and Block 1 is what exploration upper stage. The upper stage we're using for Block 1 variant of the vehicle is a the second stage. Interim cryogenic propulsion stage, ICPS, you'll hear that referred to a lot in the SOS program, but it's a second stage for Block 1. But now we hope to get to this Block 1B configuration to have a more robust upper stage. This is really the final configuration of the vehicle. This is a couple of years away because when you get to Block 2, you're really talking about improved boosters from I think in this instance, this is an illustration. See an 8.4 10 meter fairing there payload. So we're going to start with the key aspects of the key components of the vehicle. Rocket boosters, and this is what you saw on the shuttle. The difference between these are 5-segment boosters, not 4-segment that we flew on the shuttle. And what that does, it increases the thrust of each booster about 20%. These boosters each upwards of about 3.3 million pounds of thrust. We're going to run R25 engines on this vehicle. These are the shuttle main engines. A little bit filled and improved variant of these engines, but today these are pretty much reuse of 5-pound shuttle. Each at sea level will give you about 418,000 pounds of thrust. There's a lot of thrust for this vehicle. This is about 12 feet in length. And in our tank, we have a liquid oxygen tank, liquid hydrogen tank, or oxygen down somewhere. Gets all the components you need down here to the injection. We have a vehicle stage adapter. And here's that delta second stage that I mentioned, which was what we call interim cryogenic propulsion stage. And then on top, we'll fly the Orion PC. That is the vehicle, or this is the configuration of the vehicle that will fly for EM1. Let's talk a little bit about the flight that we had out of Utah in March of this year. That's really interesting. This was a hot case firing for us. We'll have a qual number 2 firing this coming year. It'll be a cold case. I can't remember the exact temperature, but we soaked the motor and got a mean propellant bulk temperature. I just changed the number off the top of my head. It was a hot case for us. A cold soak. And we'll fire that motor. Probably, I think the cold soak is 40 degrees Fahrenheit. We're processing around Utah right now for flight. This is a forward skirt structure that you see. This is one of the gas segments. Not to go into the segments you see here. And this booster, we have an avionics suite on each booster. And this is the aft skirt of the booster. It's right at the bottom of the structure. And there's a vector control subsystem in that aft skirt. Power unit controller, where we control the auxiliary to give us the hydraulic pressure we need to drive that thrust vector control system. And we have our booster avionics up here in the forward skirt. We actually can communicate with our flight computers on the forward stage. The next thing I'll kind of talk through it as we go. To see some of the videos and some of the actual hardware that we've got in process right now. What you see is they're actually inside a motor casing. They were insulated. installation. This is the fourth, they're actually dropping the igniter. Looks like the video froze. They're dropping the igniter into the structure. So we just got spot in there. For some reason. They're cleaning up the curing marks on that. Actually mixed, and a mixer, and then four, and then yours, and as I mentioned a second ago, that's where some of those curing marks. Here we go. The segment, we're going to drop the nozzle as part of the motor. The motor here is not the qual motor one, the QM1 firing I just mentioned in March. It's one of our developmental motor firing. But the end of some of our flight avionics over here in this blockhouse. It's pretty out there when you see one of these motor firing or test firing. They got a pit that goes up into the mountains out there. It's common for pulling. And a pretty proven technology, and we talked that one slide about affordability is helping us in this regard. We're pretty much reusing, in this case, shuttle technology to design, develop, and space launch system. In addition to that one segment, it's giving us a little bit more for us. This, I think you'll enjoy for 25. This is the test stand down at Stennis Space Center down in South Mississippi. And this year, we've conducted, I think, upwards of about 7 test firings now. R25 we're going to use on SLS. Controller now for those test firings. We did redesign the controller for R25. It's all new. Sea level, these engines range at about 418,000 pounds of thrust. What's going on our 4-stage vehicle? So, what you see in the process called friction stir welding into this tooling that we are, and then an automated tool come in and friction stir weld this joint that you see here. Then this tool takes, we'll put a panel in, it'll do the joint friction welding. I'm an electrician. I deal mostly with vehicles I are on a daily basis. Physics behind friction stir welding, but it's a process that's been used extensively at Marshall to develop a lot of developmental work that was done on this project done at Marshall. A shuttle, when we went to a lightweight tank, it's using friction stir welding on the shuttle. And now they're using it to build these structures. insert a tool, they spin at a very high rate of speed, generates a lot of heat, and then you weld the two joints there using that friction stir weld process. There's a, at the end, when you pull the tool out, leave a hole, and a hole size associated with that hole using a stir weld plug. And not only a structure, but a large liquid hydrogen, liquid oxygen tank structure, which you'll see here in a minute. For reef test stand, extended stand will be used for what we're going to call a green run hot fire. In the late 2017 right now, in accordance to our schedule. That's going to acceptance test the core stage before we send it down to KFC for vehicle stack. Looking at the 12-foot core stage structure I showed you earlier in the graphic, on top of the test stand for the 4.5s, we'll do tanking ops, we'll do rest rehearsals, we'll load the tank several times. Hot fire occurs, first 25s, we'll fire them in the flame pit. We'll probably burn for about 550 some odd seconds. Pretty much mission duration of firing. Structure, of course, stage engine. Reaper, and this will be used to transit from. Actually built up here to Stennis. So machine, for those who aren't familiar, machine is a large facility just north of New Orleans used for external tank fabrication. We've repurposed that facility now. We're using it for core stage fabrication. Orion also has some floor space there. They do Orion manufacturing down at machine. The core stage up to Stennis, you got a barge.
You'll move a barrel into this vertical assembly cell. You'll do that.
get the other tool, or well joint. So there's two joints, then you'll lift the barrels higher, put another barrel in that joint, so on, so you get full structure. And then you'll what you'll do when the structure is built, you'll lay it over on its side, move it to the next. We'll integrate all the avionics and all the cabling, everything else that needs to be integrated into that overall structure. This is our work that was done on EFT 1. Some of you have seen the EFT 1 when the landing entered, we had a high velocity re entry. One was launched in a Delta IV Heavy last year, and what we see is a joining of that uncrewed or unmanned Orion to the top of the Delta IV. And it was used for that mission. And it's the second stage we'll use for EM1. This is the second stage. The second stage that ULA will give us for EM1, we hope to fly a common avionics suite, which is going to prove the avionics that ULA is developing and in support of some of the commercial space launch programs. We hope to fly small-scale acoustic testing. One key consideration for this vehicle is the acoustic shock wave at ignition reflected off the bottom of the flame pit. On S1, first launch shuttle, the acoustic shock wave adequately. Some of you may hear, and they have a pretty significant reflection back up to the structure. Sure, we really understand that, so we can size the sound suppression water system to take correctly and properly. We don't want to make the same thing in the first launch. We have the booster separation test here close by at Langley. The is a little different on this vehicle than it was on the shuttle. So we understand the dynamics of that separation event. We are worried about recontact of the booster close to the engine section. So that's for us, we've been in that area to make sure our predictions. That is what we're predicting via our models. We're looking at flow down the engine section. We get a lot of heat. In the case of we're on the shuttle, you know, shuttle, we're pretty well moved from the nozzles from both boosters. In this configuration, everything in close proximity. We want to make heat flow down this engine section. And then we've been doing actuator testing. We're using the air actuators we use for this program. So we are the control authority. So we've been doing a lot of that area as well, just to ensure ourselves that we have control authority we think we have. What you see is some graphics. Here's RJ, that new engine controller that I mentioned, Windows 25 firing. This controller that's been designed specifically for Space Launch System. It's a dual channel engine controller. Gives us some redundancy. We have additional flight software load being loaded, being built for us by Aerojet Rocketdyne. And we'll communicate with that with our application software on the vehicle. What you see down here, here's the administrator. This is what in the first slide when we built this structure systems integration lab. And some development hardware. This occurred a little over a year ago. Some photos of that. But if you have a chance to come to Marshall, you'll have my contact information if you. you look me up, we'll get you a tour of that facility. I think you find it very interesting. And again, you'll see a more detailed photograph of that here. We're going to be building there to run flight equivalent hardware with our flight software. We've got a hydraulic slab connected to simulation work there. We'll run through nominal, off-nominal flyouts. We'll look at failure cases. We'll look at our warp logic. We have test capability for us for the space launch system. It's just another photo you've already seen out in Utah. Another structure for the booster. Where are our avionics located? On each booster, and here are in the core of the booster, we've got a control and power distribution unit. There are three of those on each booster, and those GPUs communicate with our flight computers, allows us to command each booster for both the separation, the whole data for activities of that nature. Operation transducer measurements, any kind of data we want to get from the booster during an asset, we pull those booster power distribution units. Operation and staging controllers on the booster, there's a unit controllers on the booster, and booster airlines pretty much contain the Forrester and the Astor. You have controllers mounted on the power package of the engines that I saw. Showed you on that previous slide. And the last stage. We'll be flying on our intermittent propulsion setup, common avionics suite I mentioned, that will fly the first vehicle. We've got a camera assembly here in this launch vehicle stage adapter. So when we get this separation event occurring, we want to have our nozzle clearance coming out of that structure. So we've got camera assemblies in there that we'll collect some imagery data with. Of the core stage. This is computers. We have those. And telemetry controller in that forward skirt structure. That's inertial nav unit that's up there in the forward skirt of the core stage. And we also have an RF transmitter. We're going to use a downlink telemetry in that forward skirt structure. The inner tank, the structure, we got liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen tank. Control and another RF transmitter. So that gives us another RF link, another RF for the vehicle. Of course, we're going to downlink all of our operational data in the tank area, downlink all our developmental data. So our flight instrumentation system will fly on E1. We'll collect that data during that. In this entertainment structure, we have a lot of data acquisition equipment. We have camera equipment. There are cameras on this looking for boosters during the separation event. Destruction during ascent, we'll collect some imagery data on that first launch. We have liquid level sensor avionics here for our main propulsion system. Here in the engine section, we have valve control. Thrust vector control system is down in that engine. Yeah, on this vehicle too for venting elements. We collect that data for our gene equipment during flight. In terms of the architecture of the vehicle, three flight computers I mentioned. And we have GPS via 15. There's not between the core vehicle and ICPS. GPS in our E1 configuration or I1 configuration is going to hold the computers on a periodic basis, and the flight computer is going to tell ICPS when to separate. We're putting in a that main engine cutoff event on the coil stage. But not a lot of communication between the core stage and ICPS. We can on a covenant RS422. High-level data link control frames cross to physical link, and this link 4 is for the up to Orion. EM1 or Block 1 config is uncrewed. We're a crewed mission that's going to be used for crew display. Information. So this is my mission. We're seeing on a periodic routine basis during ascent for any abort trigger that we're monitoring. If we see a trigger event occur, we'll give them a recommendation that says it occurs, you might be getting off the stack at this time. We can also see commands from Orion. As well as systems, mission systems, or the control center in Houston, will be able to communicate to Orion via an encrypted uplink. Command the vehicle, there are a few commands we'll be able to accept from mission systems to Orion. And Orion, or the crew, in a crewed, crewed version of the vehicle, communicate with the vehicle as well via this RS422. System on the stage and the boosters and the engine control are probably flight critical 1553 Delta 422 on four stage vehicle. But the R422 comms is mostly for communication between the flight computers and these two command controllers that we have on the vehicle. As using this architecture, the command and telemetry controllers. Basically, the gateway to the external world. So, when we're saying to command this, we're connected through each command and telemetry controller using Ethernet. So we're not at Ethernet umbilicals, the ground here. Ethernet content. HDC, each about that content for the Ethernet frame for my computers, and then the flight will interpret that information and command this distributed avionics system via these 1553 comms. Send data to the outside world. The flight will acquire that data, change it in what we call data exchange messages. Change messages are really leftovers from the Constellation program. It was a COM interoperability that we developed during Constellation, and we maintained it for this program as well. And it's in CTDS transfer program in airframes for RF to get data off the vehicle. In 1553, we communicate. We routinely, in our minor frame, poll from each component. We have subsystem managers that take that data, or a subsystem management partition that takes that data and determines what the conclusions need to be, whether it's thrust vector control actuators, whether it's valves, anything of that nature. The subsystem management partition provides outputs, and then it's sent back out to each remote control gear that's 1553 comms. It's a pretty basic free stream architecture. There's nothing over elaborate about it. We can be as robust and redundant as possible. We have a single failure tolerant environment that we meet with this vehicle. And as I mentioned, the engine controllers, there are redundant channels in each engine controller. So you have redundancy here in terms of the flight computer, and also I have internal redundancy there in terms of each engine controller. Overload and ITPS is going to be for this vehicle. I mentioned they're communicating with the core, that 1553 comm link. So once the ITPS and Orion will be relying on this software to make their orbital insertion target. So any orbital transfer type maneuvers will be done using this software on ICPS. The software flight computers, we have a load of the software and image of the software of each SC, and when we form a computer operational group of each. Three computers and form this flight computer operational group. And this is used to over when into the FCOG, each flight computer shares the data it gets on this 1553 data buses with the other flight computers. We have an input exchange process that we use. Any of those components on 1553 data bus. Yet the flight computers share that output data through an output data exchange process. The data, so we ensure bit for bit all the command messages that we call a very common. We have software line in the RENU and in the RGAs. In this case, the manufacturers of our RENU and RGA through our Prime on core stage, which is Boeing. Boeing Prime on core stage. I didn't mention that. Prime on core, orbital ATK is prime on the boosters. Jet Rocketdyne is prime on the engine. This flight design work is being done here, done in house at Marshall. The design team we have for that flight software. Comes from Aerojet Rocketdyne, and that's the software load of the engine control. And here, so this, that one picture I showed you earlier, the administration and Patrick Sherman, that this 180 ring in its infancy. So what you do is, if you were to go to our building 4205 Marshall. You can see the structure. And it's related now with development hardware. So we have engineering units, we have CPC engineering development units on that ring. We have development. So we've been doing a lot of development, a lot of development work. It's been very valuable to us. The use of FPGAs, you know, we use FPGAs all throughout the for example, in this development environment, we've been able to win out the FPA design. We've been able to modify program that goes into each FPGA based on development work that's been done on the development side of this facility. Valuable to us today. Green. And is what we call our systems integration test facility. It's going to be used for our stages element by all the core stage avionics subsystem requirements. What occurs once we've added this ring, we're going to configure this ring as a lab and flight equivalent units and flight equivalent cables for our vehicle. Where at the end of the day, we'll do a lot of probably in the calendar year 17 timeframe. We'll do a vehicle certification testing anything and everything that needs to be tested. You know, we'll test over here in the cell. You really can't see them. They're kind of on the other side of these half rings. We'll have two full-up boosters. Connect those boosters to these rings to simulate, you know, the end of the SDO, and in the case of MPC emulators, for those two programs. So this year, we still have an MPCV emulator, and we'll have GSDO advanced high fidelity. Scale up, and we'll be able to communicate basically with the launch control center here in Huntsville. And we'll have a control room. This control room is already in place. And this is where I'll get and run all those tests and figure files. To really use and make maximum use of the facility. So these facilities have a couple of facilities. The facilities are in a different building at Marshall than what you see here. We do our flight software verification testing. Paths are really development lines, or these two lines are development lines. All our development work here. Once we release the formal qualification test, send it over to SF line 3. This figure is a qual line. So we're going to have a fourth line. That fourth line will be another qual line. It'll give flexibility because two configurations that we're building on SLS. We can run application software loads. It's Dennis from that test stand showed you. That helps control the core stage during that green run hot fire test event. And then application software load. And that will be used to on the launch to actually fly the vehicle. So fourth line is one down in a flight configuration, we'll lock one down in green run configuration. We'll be those configuration items. And then we identify the need to modify those configuration items. You know, once we initial FBT and build them, we'll find defects, we'll find problems. Lines, keep them in that same configuration and do delta or delta FBTs. Whatever term works best for you. Especially testing, some people call it delta FBTs. So that's what we hope to accomplish here with our software verification. These facilities, these are known realm of what I would call flight software validation. Obviously, we continue to do validation once we build a vehicle up to KSC and do testing down there. But we have software requirements here through formal qualification tests. We work in a hardware in the loop environment, and this is really validation we begin. Because what we're here is we're testing that software in a simulator environment, and now we're going to put it here and actually have an interact with that hardware. Scheduling slide. We did a critical design review. That was here this summer. And we're getting to launch dates of July. We have a planned launch date of July 18. I think point package should be ready no later than November 2018. Ryan, people from ground. Working to a September launch date. I think there might be a couple of speakers here from Orion. They probably correct me if I'm wrong. About the earlier launch date just to give us some margin, basically. That's why you might see some differences in some of these planned launch dates that you hear from the various programs. But we really have to make this thing happen in this time frame. Again, body where I grew up on the coast, so when I was a kid, you know, we would field trips and watch all the Apollo launches. And of course, you here in this room, like me, probably work on the shuttle. So, fascinating, marvelous work of engineering. I must say, kind of the shuttle flew. It always amazed me how everything worked together. It's very exciting to be involved in a program right now. It will once again give us the capability to lean forward with humans, what we did back in the day to Apollo, and hopefully open some doors that have any questions. Right now, we're headed into this to fill one configuration near term. Eventually, we'll fill a block 1B and block 2 version, and that's kind of what you see right here with these large payload carriers. We go with humans, you get a lot of weight and a lot of volume in space. And right now, schedule, as I mentioned, we just finished script on reading, we're building hardware. Challenges, because once we get the hardware built, once we put the hardware in the systems integration labs, you know, we're gonna find folks that needs to build an exploration class launch vehicle. Some years now. Together, you know, we'll find and we'll find a challenge, you know, I think, to stay on schedule. That we're going to have to do that and try and work through problems as they arise. And then that video, which is my stage video. Probably gave you what you needed in terms of a good overview of SLS. What we're on right now, a very interesting time to be involved in the program. And any questions you might have? Yeah. Yes.
You know, let's get a phone. So we'd like to record your questions.
Okay.
From the Orion perspective, there's a lot of partnership going on with the European Space Agency with the service module and interfaces and requirements definition associated with their perspective. Are you exposed to that, any of the European Space Agency partners and interface design challenges? Or are you guys pretty much just interfacing with the Orion team and NASA?
So, saying right now, we're not facing those same challenges. We're pretty much interfacing directly with Orion, because that is primarily with the Orion capsule. A lot. Matter of fact, we were out in Denver this past August. Orion, are you from Orion?
Not formally.
Okay. And then, you know, there's the integrated test lab out in Denver at the Lockheed Martin large facility. So, similar test facility that I showed you here for our system. Plug into that test facility with an SLS vehicle emulator, and similar that we're plugging NPCV emulator into our system integration lab. But we deal with a lot of interface challenges with internal people, and also a lot of GSDO. It's oddly enough, our interface with GSDO is more complex than our interface. The capsule. Just because there's more activity. Now, when we get to a crude variant of the virus, exciting, but pretty simple. In the grand scheme of things, it's not overly
complex. Thank you. Other questions?
for the block two?
The government doesn't show the who is their system. Is it going
to no, the launch abort system, my will be the same. And the one graphic you saw there was just a non-crewed variant of block two. But if we fly humans on block two, it would be the same look and feel. You have a launch abort system on top of that. So the launch system is up-crew boost. It's going to be attached. That last is attached to the line. The last will separate or last jettison. It's after booster separation. Your guys can probably speak to that much more intelligently than I can. But at some point in time, the last will be jettisoned into a trajectory or point in the center launch when you have more benign environment will be jettisoned. But it's a capability to have. Again, we really didn't have what I would call a robust abort capability for shuttle. Concepts for, but they didn't really give you a means to get the crew off the stack if something really happened. We have a variety of abort triggers. We've been working with office abort triggers. We built that into our abort decision logic by Orion, and Orion has their own abort decision logic that they'll be using.
Other questions? No, I'd like to.